Well, my first guest tonight is Omar Bartolf. He is a professor of Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Brown University. He's the author of numerous books on war, the Holocaust, genocide, and anti-Semitism. He joins me tonight from Cambridge, Massachusetts. Professor Bartolf, it's good to have you back on to the program. You and I, we spoke late last year, I think it was around November, right after you had written a piece for the New York Times, in which you said it was crucial to warn of the potential for genocide before it occurs. And you added in that article that there is still time to do this. Now, that was November. Here we are in January. Is there still time?
Well, that's a very good question. And I guess that the International Court of Justice will have to determine that, or at least debate it. Look, I mean, my own sense is, and I've just read all 84 pages of the South African file to the ICJ. There are many indications, if not of genocide, then of genocidal acts, and certainly of war crimes and crimes against humanity and an evolving operation of ethnic cleansing. So mm-hmm. whether this is fully genocide or not will have to be determined, but the situation on the ground, the direction that it's taking has to be reversed as quickly as possible.
Mm-hmm. I want to talk about the case being put forth by South Africa in just a moment. I want to play a clip for you now from the Israeli government spokesman, Mark Regev, a comment that was given today, and I want to get your reaction to it. Take a listen.
The South African government prides itself on heading a country, they call it the Rainbow Nation, a nation which has anti-racism as its core. And yet here we see South Africa, unfortunately, aligning itself with the Hamas terrorist organization, which is an openly and avowedly racist organization. It's a travesty of history.
What do you say to that, Professor? You know, aligning itself with Hamas?
Well, I mean, let's face it, it's nonsense. I mean, I don't know whether Regev read the filing by South Africa. It does not align itself with Hamas. It talks about extremely violent actions by the IDF against the Palestinian population of Gaza. Now, if Regev, as many other spokespeople, generals, politicians in Israel, thinks that Hamas and the population of Gaza are the same thing, then you could say that. But that means that statements that were made against Hamas by various spokespeople in Israel were actually directed at the entire population, which is very much the case. That is, there's a kind of confusion between Hamas, which is a terrorist organization, and it would be a nice thing if it could be removed from Gaza, and between mm-hmm. the 2.3 million people who live there, half of whom are children.
How significant is it that South Africa has brought Israel to the world court by invoking the 1948 Genocide Convention? I mean, is this a historic moment?
It is a historic moment on various levels. First of all, because the Genocide Convention from 1948, which came into force in 1951, the year that Israel joined it as well, the roots of that are really the Holocaust and other cases of mass killing in World War II. And this was what was the impetus for the newly founded UN to resolve to have such a convention. So that is one side of it. That is that for a state like Israel, which was founded in many ways on the ashes of the Holocaust, to be accused of genocide is a very tragic moment. The second is that South Africa was a country that, as we know, until 1994, suffered under a regime, a very brutal regime of apartheid, and became a pariah state. And because of that, eventually, because of international pressure, that regime ultimately collapsed. And the additional irony is that one of the only states that worked with the South African apartheid regime, particularly in military cooperation, was the state of Israel. So there's a fair amount of bad blood between those two states, whereas in fact, as I see it, they should have been much closer together. They're both countries founded on historical tragedies, and they should find a common path rather than going the other way.
You know, you mentioned a pariah in the international community. You know as well as I do that a ruling by the World Court may take years to come, and by then, the war between Israel and Hamas will probably be over. There could even be peace in the Middle East. And we know that this court has no enforcement authority. So is the court of public opinion here, public pressure, is that most relevant with what we're seeing happening?
There are three things that are relevant, I think. One is that you will have an international body of 15 justices plus one from South Africa and one from Israel, happens to be a very distinguished jurist, who will adjudicate this case, who will deliberate it, and that's important on its own. The second is, yes, that there will be pressure simply because of the fact that the ICJ would be talking about it. The third is that South Africa, aware of that, that the deliberations could take a year or longer, but could be several years, is asking for provisional measures. And those provisional measures can be decided on by the ICJ in the next couple of weeks. And those would have much more, even if they're not implemented, which one expects they would not be, would have a much greater immediate effect of pressure, both on Israel and not least on the United States.
You have said, and I think you said this when we talked last year, that it's important to show that a country is sliding towards genocide when it is sliding towards genocide. That means, though, that the presence of intent has to be there. How does one prove intent when we're talking about Israel allegedly committing genocide against the Palestinian people?
So, you know, even when I published that op-ed in the New York Times in early November, I cited many cases of Israeli political and military leaders, people with executive powers, making genocidal statements, or statements that could have two implications. One is that they incite people, and they incite soldiers. And when you have hundreds of thousands of reserve soldiers who are just Israeli citizens in uniform hearing their commanders and their political leaders making such statements, it, of course, has an impact on their conduct. And secondly, that is an element in proving genocide, which usually is very hard to prove. Now, since then, there have been many more such statements made. And in the filing by South Africa, there's a very long laundry list of statements from top to bottom around the country, even in the last few days, which, of course, some people in Israel say is crazy, because this is not the moment to keep making such statements. The question will be whether these statements are being made in the heat of the moment. They are just sort of rhetoric, but they don't actually have to do with actions on the ground, that Israel does not actually intend to destroy the Palestinian people as such, or at least its part in Gaza.
Right, but how do you prove that, though, Professor? How do you prove that there is a true intent, even if you have people in the cabinet saying horrible things? How do you make that connection that what they say is translating into conduct on the ground in Gaza, and an entire people, an ethnic group, is being extinguished?
Correct. You have to make the link. And the link can be made, or might be made, by looking at what the actions actually are. And the actions have been that 85% of the population of Gaza have been displaced and are now mostly in the southwestern tip of the Gaza Strip, where they are also under conditions of lack of food, lack of water, lack of sanitation, lack of medical assistance. The places from which they were displaced have been largely destroyed. and that there's no clear plan of them ever coming back there, and no political horizon because the Israeli government refuses to speak of the next stage.
But is that true, though? I mean, you're describing a humanitarian catastrophe. I mean, human suffering, we've seen the images, that is true. But can we say that there will not be a plan for resettling Gaza, for these people to go home? I mean, we know that there are mechanisms in place already to finance reconstruction of Gaza. No one is talking about the annihilation of Gaza and its people.
Well, many people are talking about that in Israel. Statements have been made by two senior ministers in the Israeli cabinet precisely about encouraging the Palestinians to leave. Encouraging, obviously, is a polite term to pushing them out. Mm-hmm. I think that in a sense, we will know whether this is an operation of ethnic cleansing with genocidal intent or consequence, depending on what happens next. If indeed the plan is implemented mm-hmm. for Palestinians to go back to where they were, to rebuild their lives, then potentially we could say, okay, this was very close, but it didn't quite come to that. 23,000 people were killed, thousands and thousands wounded and mutilated, but maybe it didn't get to be genocide or ethnic cleansing because people came back.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure that this will happen.
Final question before we run out of time. You know, South Africa, as you said, says it has a history of solidarity with the Palestinians, that they both have stories of apartheid, oppression to tell. Other groups in the world are also targets of all kinds of horrible treatment. I'm thinking about the Uyghurs in China, the Rohingya of Myanmar. It seems, though, that some get more attention than others, that solidarity likes to pick and choose, too. Does it?
Well, first of all, of course, it's true. I mean, we don't live in a fair and just world. But I would say that the only other case in which one state filed with the ICJ for a case of genocide was the Gambia, about the genocide of the Rohingya in Myanmar in 2019. And this did go, was deliberated by the ICJ and is, in fact, one of the only precedents for what we are seeing now. Secondly, I would say that Israel is in a particularly sort of delicate moment. Israel has claimed always to be the only democracy in the Middle East, to have had a very moral, or the most moral, army in the world. It has built itself on the legacy of the Holocaust. So for a country like Israel to be even charged with this, is not just that it's unfair that people are going after Israel. It also has to do with a sort of lack of sensibility and understanding of its own historical, political position in the world by Israeli leaders. And that I find tragic internally, domestically, not only internationally, that that Israel would bring itself to this point.
Professor Bartov, unfortunately, we're out of time. We appreciate you taking the time to talk with us. Great conversation. I'm sure there will be reasons to talk again in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much for having me.